Libby and I both love the kind of YouTube videos where filmmakers dissect their movie scenes. It gives us a lot of insight as to why directors chose to block a scene a certain way, why cinematographers chose a specific lighting technique, or even why an actor chose to convey a certain emotion. Now, we don't have any qualifications nor a minute of filmography to analyze. We do love movies. We love talking about how the movement of a scene gives us context, how the lighting of a room made us feel, or why a performance feels authentic. Libby and I have this ongoing conversation about our favorite scenes and sequences in film, and they often come from romantic comedies. For some reason, rom-coms have been relegated to those movies that your asshole boyfriend refuses to see, but they have some really good cinematic qualities to them. Think about the movies that affected you the most. You know, the ones that have made you cry so hard that you almost threw up, or the ones that have made you laugh so hard that you had to pause it while you were watching it. I bet at least one of them is a rom-com. Now, to show some appreciation to an underrated genre, and honestly, to save you guys from watching another compilation of white men getting angry and destroying things.
Alright, it's all gone! I've abandoned my child!
We wanted to share our favorite rom-com scenes. Before he gave some of his most emotionally complex performances in Punch Drunk Love, Uncut Gems, and the infamous Little Nicky, Adam Sandler played Robbie Hart in 1998's The Wedding Singer. Robbie is the titular wedding singer and wannabe rock star who falls in love with the waitress, Julia Sullivan, played by Drew Barrymore. After Robbie is left at the altar, his friendship with Julia blossoms once he gives into her pleas to join her on wedding planning activities. Spending a lot of quality time together doing things an engaged couple normally would causes feelings to arise. Eventually, this forces Julia to question her engagement to Glenn, but before she can even tell Robbie, she finds his ex, Linda, in nothing but his Van Halen t-shirt at his house. Julia then haphazardly books a flight to Vegas to get hitched as soon as possible. Once Robbie finds out, we enter into the classic man rushes to the airport to get the girl scenario.
Go get her.
All right.
With the help of the flight crew and the rest of first class, Robbie realizes that they're on the same flight as Julie and Glenn, and they all create a plan to help win her over. It starts with Billy Idol giving an announcement to the rest of the passengers that there'll be some in-flight entertainment, and then Robbie begins singing his newly written song.
I wanna make you smile whenever you're sad, carry you around when your arthritis is bad. All I wanna do is grow old with you.
Let's pause for a second to talk about why these lyrics mean so much. Earlier in the movie, Julia mentioned to Robbie two important things. For one, it's always the little things in relationships that count. And also, that she always envisioned the right one being someone she could see herself growing old with.
I always just envisioned the right one being someone I could see myself growing old with.
It isn't until he sees his neighbor Rosie sing for her husband at their 50th wedding anniversary that it hits him. That timeless love that Rosie and her husband share for each other is something that he wants with Julia. He sees himself growing old with her, and not only that, he wants to care about the little things, something neither of them have experienced before. And with that context, the mundane things Robbie sings about mean so much more. Yeah, growing old sucks, but that doesn't matter, because at least they get to do it together.
I'll get you medicine when your tummy aches, build you a fire if the furnace breaks, so it could be so nice growing old with you. I'll miss you, kiss you, give you my coat when you are cold. Need you, feed you, even let you hold the remote control.
As the song continues, Glenn gets increasingly angry and tries to stop Robbie, but the flight crew, joined by Billy Idol, shut him down.
Get out of the way!
Excuse me, sir, I have to serve the beverages.
Throughout this entire movie, Glenn has been this misogynistic asshole who treats Julia poorly and cheats on her.
How you doing, sir? Chicken or fish?
You better get out of my way, Billy. You're gonna get hurt.
Oh, yeah?
Don't you talk to Billy Idol that way.
Seeing Glenn finally get put in his place while Julie enjoys her song is just pure bliss.
Let me do the dishes in our kitchen sink. Put you to bed when you've had too much to drink. Oh, I could be the man who grows old with you.
This song is the perfect way for Robbie to confess his love. We know from the very beginning that he wants to write songs, and before this, we've only really heard him sing one original song. It was the one about his ex, and when he sang it, it really didn't go over too well.
On my knees, pretty, pretty, please, kill me, I want to die, put a bullet in my head.
Seeing him find his muse and write such a beautiful song to the love of his life is an amazing feeling.
I am so in love with you.
The movie wastes no time and immediately shows them getting married. I know this is pretty typical for rom-coms, but honestly, it doesn't feel rushed. The entire movie has been leading up to this point. We feel sad for Robbie because he was left at the altar and wants nothing more than to have a family. And we feel bad for Julia because she's been engaged to someone who treats her like shit. And as they walk down the aisle as newlyweds, and Steve Buscemi sings a cover of Spandau Ballet's True, we get a stronger faith in true love.
It's true, oh yes I do, Robbie and Julia.
When I was thinking of a great rom-com sequence for this video, I had to pull out an iconic, all-time favorite Ryan Gosling film. The quintessential Gosling romance, you could say. That's right, I'm talking about Lars and the Real Girl. In Lars and the Real Girl, Ryan Gosling plays the titular Lars, who is a kind, socially awkward man living in the garage of his childhood home. Lars is terrified of connecting with people. Even with his own brother Gus and his sister-in-law Karen, who despite their best efforts, have a hard time getting Lars to make the journey across the driveway just for dinner.
Lars! Come on, you promised!
Just because Lars avoids people in his life doesn't mean he doesn't want a relationship with them. The opposite is actually true. Lars craves love.
New girl's kinda cute, huh? You and Margo, what do you think?
But it's difficult to create relationships when you live in a self-imposed isolation and find any form of physical contact painful. To fill that gap in his life, he manifests a loving relationship with a sex doll named Bianca. But before we get to Bianca, let's talk about Margot.
Give this to somebody nice. First art.
Hello, Lars.
Margot is the new girl at Lars's work. She's playful, inviting, and warm. The slow build of Lars's attraction to Margot is perfectly crafted. It starts with little things like small glances from Lars, which builds to larger affections, like Margot's complete acceptance of Bianca.
I can help you with your coats.
The movie does this because they want to make it clear that Margot doesn't just have a crush, she truly cares for Lars.
Hey. Hi, Bianca.
And this leads to my favorite set of sequences. It starts with a prank gone wrong. Margot had previously hidden action figures from a coworker who, in retaliation, ties a noose made from an extension cord to Margot's beloved teddy bear. When Margot finds it, she's not just annoyed, she's practically in tears. She demands the coworker take the noose off, but he refuses. When Margot storms off, Lars follows. He doesn't make fun or tell her it's not a big deal, he actually listens to her. He listens as she explains her reaction isn't about the bear at all, but about her recent breakup with her boyfriend. All the while, Lars is performing CPR on the bear to revive it, but to also make her laugh. And I always found this scene fascinating because up to this point, we've spent so much time watching Lars treat a doll as a living person, and never once does he allude to the fact that he understands Bianca's not real until now. It's pretty clear that he understands the bear is not the actual issue, And it's clear that he hears her when she explains the actual reason she's upset. And he treats her and the teddy bear, which is this extension of her, with care. He understands that having this cute bear on her desk is something that comforts her, something that fills in the gap that her breakup created, and he doesn't dismiss its meaning to her. He revives it. And to thank Lars, Margot invites him to go bowling. This scene is the first time we see Lars genuinely happy without Bianca. Even when where people crash their non-date, he doesn't really let it keep him from having a good time. And before we get to my favorite part, I have to take a detour to talk about Lars's therapist, Dagmar. Under the guise of treating Bianca for an unknown illness, Dagmar helps Lars through the underlying issues that created Bianca. One of them being how painful it is when people touch him.
But it's such a comfort sometimes just to have somebody's arms around you, don't you think?
No.
Come on, it feels good.
It does not feel good, it hurts. Like when you go outside and your feet freeze and then you come back in and they thaw out, it's like that.
He makes it clear, though, that the only person who can touch him without pain is Bianca. So back at the bowling alley, things are winding down and Lars is saying goodnight to Margot. They have an awkward interaction where Lars reminds her, and maybe even himself, that he indeed has a girlfriend.
I never could cheat on Bianca ever.
No. Oh my god, I hope you didn't think that, Lars. I would never do that.
When they get outside, Lars takes off his glove and reaches out his bare hand to shake Margot's. She removes her mitt and puts her hand in his. For a moment, we expect a flash of pain on Lars's face, but instead, he smiles. Their hands linger as Lars's face looks surprised and maybe even a little bit relieved. Even in the cold, dark night, Margot's hand isn't painful. It's warm. Something I learned while researching for this video is that Lars and the Real Girl is actually very similar to Ovid's story of Pygmalion, the man who fell in love with the statue. By the end of the story, Pygmalion's love is powerful enough to turn the statue into a real woman. And while the love Lars feels for Bianca doesn't turn her into a real woman, it is powerful enough to give him the courage to love at all. And now for our last movie. We went a little unconventional in our selection this time. In 2014's Nightcrawler, Jake Gyllenhaal plays Lou Bloom, opposite a mirror. And you'll never guess what happens next. Just kidding. We're done for now. See you next time.